Welcome back to the One Question Leadership Podcast. I'm Glenn Caruso, head football coach at the University of St. Thomas, and so happy you tuned in. My dad was the single greatest man I ever met. He used to tell me, Glenn, I'm not going to tell you how to be a man. I'm going to be a man. I'm going to let you watch me, and you're welcome. That always struck me very deeply. My dad never intended to try and make my path easy or smooth or devoid of any hurdles. He understood that that very strain and struggle was part of the journey that's going to make every one of us into the person that we're intended to be. I would encourage everybody to think when they're leading people that our job is to prepare the child for the path and not the path for the child. And remember, if we're doing it right, we're coaching football for life.
Greetings, this is Ty Brown and welcome to the One Question Leadership Podcast, where we highlight executive and organizational leadership. Be sure to follow us on social media at 1Q Leadership. Our guest today is Tavares Hardy. Tavares is the head men's basketball coach at Loyola University, Maryland. Greetings, coach. Thanks for joining us today.
Hey, Ty. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Now, coach, this is your 14th season in the basketball coaching profession and your second season as a head coach. Of course, you played ball at Northwestern, spent some time as an assistant coach at a number of different places, most recently Georgia Tech, and now you find yourself in your second year as a head basketball coach. I think that's a wonderful progression as a career. But I do have some questions for you in terms of leadership in the head coaching role, especially someone like yourself who's a relatively new leader in a head coaching role. We're into your second season here and you're ramping up leading towards conference play. And I wonder what aspects of your leadership have you adjusted since your first season as a head coach?
Yeah, that's a great question. Year one, based on my experiences as an assistant coach at places like Georgia Tech, Georgetown, Northwestern, I realized that it was important for us here at Loyola University, Maryland, to invest in the foundation and the culture right off the bat. And so, I wouldn't stray away from that year one. I wasn't thinking about how can we get a quick victory here or whatnot. It was all about really locking in on laying the foundation for a future successful program. And so the guys adapted, they understood what we were trying to do, was able to capture their buy-in. And so I think we had a very successful year one. For year two, now that we've sort of laid the foundation, we've talked a lot about, all right, it's time to take the next step and still not get ahead of ourselves. So for this year, from a leadership standpoint, I've really locked in on transparency and accountability. And so the guys understand what we're trying to do. They understand why we're trying to do it. And now it's time for me to continue to show them when and where they're doing well or not doing well, and then hold them accountable to maintaining that culture. And it's been a good start for us year two so far, and I'm going to keep that going for them.
Right. The difference between academia and life, right? In academia, you study a lesson and then you take the test. In life, you take the test and then you learn the lesson after you've taken the test. So I wonder if there was anything in terms of your first year that caught you off guard, and now you've learned from it, and now you adjust accordingly as you continue being the head coach.
Yeah, I mean, there's always certain things that you learn from a leadership standpoint, from an X's and O's standpoint. I would say one thing in particular, last year I wanted to capture their buy-in in a way that they saw it, and so I didn't talk about it a whole lot in terms of I set up a few parameters, a few competitions, if you will. And this is no knock on the previous staff, and it's never an indictment of the previous coaches, but there were certain metrics that I set up that I wanted to beat based on what they were able to do the year before. And, the team had lost two starters, lost the leading score, but I didn't care. I wanted to win a couple metrics based on that year. And I think that competition, sort of gave me some confidence with those small victories. We didn't blow it out of the water, but we did it enough to where the guys were able to see, okay, if we listen to coach, we can make some strides. We can see some success. And so taking from that into year two, again, they understood it, but now I want it to be more direct. And so I am more transparent with the numbers. I'm more transparent with the statistics, the analytics, so that now they can see, okay, you had moderate success, but we want to have great success. And that's just one of the main things that I've learned, that, the guys, when they see it on paper and they see it on film, they really take it to heart.
Yeah, the evaluation, right? If it, as a leader, right, what's worth doing is worth measuring just to see if we've done it well. You talk about evaluation as a leader, right? Especially in sports, you know, beyond wins and losses, how do you evaluate yourself as a leader and really your staff, right? How do you evaluate those things, especially the introspection that comes with leading a program?
Absolutely. It's funny, being at a Jesuit institution, it's one of the core principles of our Jesuit values. We have to examine ourselves. We have to constantly self-reflect and, you know, be honest. And so that's one thing I take a lot of pride in, very real with myself and constantly evaluating, self-evaluating. And I challenge my staff and my players to do the same. And so I have sort of a balanced scorecard that I analyze myself and my staff on. That's outside of, like you said, just the wins and losses. And so number one on that scorecard is the student-athlete experience. And there's so many things that go into that, you know, holding them accountable to the mission and values, their on-court player development, their off-court player development, you know, the game strategy, health and wellness. There's so many things. You know, that's the first bucket that we really look at. Then we look at efficient operations. Are we an efficiently run organization? Again, that doesn't necessarily, you know, equate to exactly winning and losing, but those things, when you add them all up, will. We look at learning and innovation. That's our third sort of pod that we evaluate. Are we pushing ourselves to get better, to constantly improve? Are we just sitting on our hands and being comfortable, which is unacceptable? And so that's another area. And then the final is the quantitative performance. But it's beyond just wins and losses. We look at, as I addressed earlier, the analytics of things. We look at, are we efficiently operating within our budget? Are we doing everything that it takes to help generate revenue? And so we look at all the quantitative stuff behind that. And when you combine those four things, those four categories, we feel like if you do those things well, you hold yourself accountable to doing all those things and putting a lot of effort into it, then you'll have a successful men's basketball program. All the winning and losing will be a product of that.
Right. All right. Of those things. I wonder about the interpersonal aspects, which a lot of those things hit that. But you yourself, if you know, you had to get on a kid's case, or you had to talk to be straightforward with one of your assistants about something. I wonder if you ever questioned, like, did I handle that the best way, or it's just, you know what, I did that, and hopefully they're better for it. Or talk to me about the interpersonal type, when you go home at night type questions you may have.
Absolutely. I'm a firm believer in this thing only works if you have authentic relationships. And that's across the board. That's with my staff, and it can't just be work. You know, it has to be more. It's with all of our support folks around here, administrators, but also specifically and most importantly with our players. It can't be a situation, if I'm going to demand excellence from them and they don't trust me because they don't know me or they don't really have a feel for who I am as a person, as a father, as a husband. And so we make sure that we build authentic relationships with our guys. So much of what I talked about on that balanced scorecard doesn't have anything to do with being on the court. You know, we challenge our guys to be great. That's part of our mission, to be great in everything they do. And that includes, from a collegiate athlete standpoint, that's basketball, that's their academics, that's, you know, we challenge them in leadership categories, and we challenge them to affect positive change on their communities. And so we talk about all that stuff for real. Like, it's not a game with us. You know, we have crazy conversations. We talk about real issues, and I let my guard down. I share my personal beliefs, and I don't do it in a way to try to influence them to think the way I think. You know, I challenge their thoughts, they challenge my thoughts, and we communicate on it. We talk about things, we talk about race, we talk about politics, we talk about sports, we talk about life. And I think that, you know, because we're doing it in an authentic and real way, it really helps us bond and helps our chemistry as a you know, with the staff and the players and the university as a whole, to be honest.
Which helps you sleep well at night, knowing that everything is authentic, right? There wasn't something that doesn't sit well because everybody didn't represent themselves the way you know they will.
Exactly, exactly. And, you know, when you look at it, one quick story, we have a guy, a senior on our team, Kavon Scott, who, you know, last year I met all these guys for the first time, and I kind of got a chance to get to know him a little bit, and I saw that he had some potential. He was quiet. He did well in school. When he did speak, he had a pretty good voice. And so I just challenged him and encouraged him to use it and do more. And we hadn't had a student athlete advisory committee representative, the SAC group, from men's basketball for a while. I was brought to my attention, and so I asked him to consider it. Well, since then, he not only joined last year, he was elected co-president this year, and that's a big deal to have a men's basketball player, leading that organization or helping to lead that organization. He's also a member of the Green and Gray Society, which at Loyola is a big deal. It's 14 students that report directly to the president and his cabinet on certain issues, and was nominated by our academic advisor, Colleen Campbell. But the fact that he was selected for that is a big deal, and now that's trickling down to our other guys where they see that and they want to be a part of that as well.
Yeah, that's excellent, right? The influence of leadership. Now, you mentioned you told us about your how you evaluate yourselves and your staff and really the team as a whole, and the last metric was wins and losses. And you also mentioned that year two is still a learning year for you, and winning is a necessity, but losses happen. I wonder, as a head coach, especially starting off as a head coach, how do you keep yourself from, for the lack of a better word, beating yourself up after a loss? And then conversely, how do you keep yourself from getting too high after a win?
Yeah, it's challenging. It's one of the most challenging things in our business. I worked on Wall Street before I got into coaching, and I used to tell my guys when I first started coaching, there were days where you may lose a client, not through no fault of your own, just the way the markets go. They may lose $1 million or more, and at the end of the day, you feel bad, but you couldn't control it, and so on Friday, 5 o'clock, you're still going home or going to happy hour, whatever you do. And, you don't think about it again until Monday. These things in college sports, we live with them, day in and day out. We're watching film all day, all night, preparing our thoughts. And so, one thing I tell our guys, it is challenging, to deal with the highs and the lows, but, the cool part about this business is there's always another opportunity that's going to come. And so what we talk about is we embrace the journey. And so in other words, we lock in on the process. And as long as we take care of our business in practice, as long as we go about our business the right way in preparation, we watch enough film, we do everything we can to put ourselves in position to go out and execute, then we can move on after a tough loss. The wins, the same thing. We can't sit back and expect everything to go the same way every time. We got to lock back in on the journey. And if we, when we do that, we found that we can be very successful that way.
Right. Let's make an assumption here that maybe there's some young basketball coach assistants or even football, whatever sport, young coaches who plan to be a head coach at some point in the near future. Do you have any one or two words of advice for those guys in terms of leadership, well, guys or girls, in terms of leadership or in terms of like managing an organization, managing personalities, leading staff and those kind of things for people who try to be a head coach at some point in the future?
Yeah, absolutely. As I'm sure everyone heard, but I'm going to repeat it because it is the most important thing. First and foremost, you have to be good at what you're currently doing. No one's going to want to invite you into a bigger role if all you're doing is thinking about getting to a bigger role. You have to make sure that you're doing your job as a young associate AD or young assistant coach or whatever you may be. You have to be the best for that at that job that you could possibly be, and make sure that everyone knows it, not in a braggadocious kind of way, but just in a, you just go about your business the right way and everyone sees it. And then beyond that, you are mentally preparing for the future. And so just be mindful of the things that may come up in the future. Be mindful of the fact that it is important to have an identity. Who are you? And that's not just off the court, but on the court as well. What's your trademark? How are you going to present yourself when you are sitting in front of a decision maker to be able to show that you're the right person for the job? Know yourself enough to know which jobs you want to go after. Don't go after a job just to get a job. That's where I think I made my best decision. I was very intentional about going after a job like Loyola. I wasn't going after every single job. I understood what Loyola was all about. You never know exactly, but I knew, looking at the university mission, that it was aligned with my thoughts. And so that's what I was able to portray in my interview, and that's why I was able to get the job. And I feel like going into my second year, we're experiencing success because I knew what I was getting into, and I had a plan that could fit this place in particular. So that'd be the main things. I don't want to keep rambling. There's so much more, but knowing for sure, knowing the type of person you are so that you can go after the jobs that suit you. Don't just go after just any job or take a job because you can get it. That would be my main piece of advice.
All right. And that's all those are excellent keys to leadership and to career progression, specifically if you talk about being a head coach or being an athletics director. Tavares, this has been an excellent conversation. I really appreciate you joining us here on the One Question Leadership Podcast.
All right. Thank you, Ty. I really appreciate you.
That was Coach Tavares Hardy. He's the head men's basketball coach at Loyola University, Maryland. And of course, this is Ty Brown with the One Question Leadership Podcast. And keep in mind, the role of a leader is to create and maintain an environment that people want to be a part of. And as always, be better tomorrow than you are today.
This episode of the One Question Leadership Podcast is produced by Spades Media Group, solving problems using creative leadership.